Okay, the next item of business is the debate on motion 14469 in the name of Sue Webber on behalf of the Education, Children and Young People Committee on additional support for learning. I would invite members wishing to participate in the debate to press the request to speak buttons as soon as possible, and I invite Ms Webber, convener on behalf of the committee, up to 10 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'll start by moving the motion in my name. I am delighted to be speaking today on behalf of the Education, Children and Young People Committee about our inquiry into additional support for learning. And I'd like to thank my colleagues for their diligent work throughout our inquiry and all the people and organisations who provided evidence either in person or by responding to our call for views. And I want to give a special thanks to the Inclusion Ambassadors who we met with. These are a group of children and young people from across Scotland with a range of additional support needs, who work with children in Scotland to ensure their views are heard in decision-making relating to education. In deciding what this inquiry should cover, the committee was acutely aware of the work that was being done in this area, not least the report produced by Angela Morgan. And we also knew that the Scottish Government was planning to update its ASL Action Plan and Code of Practice. And we wanted to ensure that the main issues around ASL provision in Scotland's schools were both highlighted to the Scottish Government and addressed within the refresh plan and code of practice. As it was 20 years since the 2004 Act had been passed, it did feel like a good time to reflect on progress that had or had not been made, but also explore what still remained to be done. And the committee agreed to focus on three main themes, all of which overlapped to some extent. And these were the implementation and presumption of mainstreaming, the impact of COVID on additional support for learning, and the use of remedies as set out in the 2004 Act. We launched our inquiry back in October 2023, and we issued a call for views and received over 600 responses. And these were mainly from individuals, to be fair, who had faced barriers in relation to ASL provision. Currently, over a third of all pupils have an additional support need, and many of those will require additional support with their learning, and we cannot therefore ignore the enormity of the situation. At the outset of the inquiry, the committee was keen to hear directly from those with personal experience of how the 2004 Act and the presumption of mainstreaming was working in practice. So we spoke to pupils, parents and carers and teachers at informal participation sessions in February and March, and we then took formal evidence throughout March before publishing our report in May. Our report makes it clear the committee was extremely concerned by what it heard regarding the negative personal experiences of ASL provision and the detrimental impact this had on some pupils with ASN, their parents and their carers. We commended the work done by teachers and support staff in providing support for pupils with ASN, but we were concerned to hear of the pressures they faced, leaving them feeling overwhelmed and burnt out. The committee was also concerned to hear parents and carers describe themselves as fighting for the right resources to be put in place for their children, something that we found wholly unacceptable. Turning to the implementation of the presumption of mainstreaming, the committee was only too aware of the Scottish Government's GIRFIC policy, Getting It Right for Every Child. It's intended to provide all children, young people and their families with the right support at the right time in order that their child and young person in Scotland can reach their full potential. Sadly, this was not what we heard was happening with many pupils with ASN. We were alarmed to hear that there was strong evidence to suggest that the majority of ASN pupils were not having their needs met. And while we agreed with the policy intention behind the presumption of mainstreaming set out in the Education Scotland Act of 2000, we found that the gap between policy intention and how this has been implemented in practice was intolerable. Parents and carers told us of the difficulties in getting the correct support for their child and of the misconception that a formal diagnosis was not only desirable but necessary in order to obtain that support. We recommended that the Scottish Government provides clarity in the Code of Practice on how support could be provided to pupils with ASN whether or not they have that formal diagnosis, including from agencies other than education. And the Scottish Government confirmed that a formal diagnosis or identification is not required for a child or young person to receive appropriate support with their learning, and committed to providing further clarity on this issue in the refresh of the Supporting Children's Learning Code of Practice. Long delays in accessing specialist provision with a mainstream setting, within that mainstream setting rather, was another issue raised by so many witnesses, and this has included accessing CAMHS support and speech and language therapy. We recommended that the Scottish Government work closely with bodies such as NHS Scotland, the Royal College of Speech and Language Therapists, CAMHS and COSLA to identify the causes of such lengthy delays and ensure that a much more joined-up approach to providing specialist support is adopted in the future. And we also heard concerning evidence in relation to neurodivergent pupils masking at school. And that is pupils who expend a lot of energy trying to modify their behaviour to try and mask the true extent of their neurodivergence at school. This inevitably meant that when they got home, they were completely overwhelmed and exhausted and placed huge additional pressure on them and their families. We said that much more must be done to understand the prevalence of masking in schools and the effect that it's having on pupils' school and home lives, in particular the impact on parents and carers. And the Scottish Government has indeed agreed to undertake a literature review on masking for children and young people with ASL and identify relevant theories, methods and gaps in existing knowledge with the aim of strengthening its existing resources. And we are pleased that our report has helped make that happen, and we will wait the results of that literature review with interest. For those pupils where a mainstream setting was not appropriate, we were concerned to hear that pupils with ASN do not always have access to adequate special school provision near them. And that's meant that through no fault of their own, some pupils are having to spend significant time travelling to and from school each day. And we concluded that given the increase in the number of ASL bases and units within schools in the 20 years since the 2004 Act was passed, that the Scottish Government should undertake a full review of placing requests to specialist services to consider how the current regime is actually working in practice. As part of our inquiry, we heard that the physical environment of school can also have a huge impact on pupils with ASN. For example, many recently built schools have been designed in a way that's not accessible to all. Current large campuses with open plan designs can act as a barrier to learning for pupils with ASN, and in particular for pupils who are neurodivergent. On the existing school estate, we were told of many relatively inexpensive adaptations which can be made to improve accessibility for pupils with ASN. And we've recommended that the Scottish Government and the Scottish Futures Trust reassess the support and advice provided to local authorities to ensure that schools are designed as accessible and welcoming environments for all. And the Scottish Government responded to our concerns regarding the physical environment, and they've told us that the Scottish Futures Trust has developed a 10-step plan to address the issues raised by the committee. And this will include stakeholder involvement, and we hope to be updated on that work early in the next year. As I said, we also looked at the impact of COVID-19 on ASL, and witnesses spoke of the anxiety and difficulties experienced by pupils with ASN attending school post-pandemic. We heard that for some pupils with ASN who are not coping and whose needs are not being met, that this impact can really have an impact on their behaviour and well-being. The resulting behaviour is often disruptive and detrimental, and this can negatively impact not only on the pupil with ASN, but also affect learning and mental well-being of other pupils in the classrooms, and sometimes lead to the pupil with ASN being alienated. We heard of a disproportionate number of pupils with ASN being excluded from school and recommended that further work be undertaken by the Scottish Government and COSLA to establish the reasons for this and what can be done to make improvements. Again, the Scottish Government accepted this recommendation and said it was currently engaging with COSLA, ADES and Education Scotland to consider this recommendation in detail. Finally, Presiding Officer, the inquiry explored the use of remedies for parents and carers when things are not working well. And I don't have time to cover all of what we heard, but will highlight what a number of witnesses told us. The current ASL landscape would be cluttered and confusing. And as a result of our report, the Cabinet Secretary committed to look at the communication mechanisms with families in relation to parents, carers and pupils' rights and parental and pupil involvement in the decision-making process. The Parliament notes the conclusions and recommendations contained in the Education, Children and Young People's Committee second report, and that's the motion in my name, Presiding Officer. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Webber. I now call on Jenny Gold-Ruth, Cabinet Secretary, around 9 minutes, please.
Presiding Officer, I welcome the opportunity to respond to the Education, Children and Young People's Committee report on additional support for learning. And I would like to thank the convener, the committee members and the clerks for all their work and commitment to this really important topic. I'd also like to thank those who took the time to contribute to the inquiry, whether that was in writing or in person, to provide the committee with evidence of their lived experiences, as we've heard from the convener this afternoon, their knowledge and also their expertise. As committee members will be aware, I committed to pausing the latest update of the Additional Support for Learning Action Plan during my evidence session to the committee earlier this year. And that was done quite deliberately to ensure that we fully considered and listened to the outcomes of the committee's inquiry. And it's very much in that spirit that I will engage in and respond to the debate today to ensure that the response from government takes cognizance of the committee's views. Today, as we have heard from the convener, the numbers of pupils in Scotland's schools with an additional support need stand at a record high. And as noted in the National Discussion on Education, that is a key feature and a strength of Scotland's unique and our inclusive education system. Our additional support needs pupils are not additional. They are part of the fabric of our approach to school education. Presiding Officer, the committee unanimously agreed that the highly inclusive approach embodied in the policy and legislation that we have in Scotland is the right one, and I firmly agree. And we should celebrate that inclusive nature of our approach to education in Scotland, particularly mindful that it was not always the case in the recent past. That being said, I cannot stand here today without acknowledging we still have challenges within the system, from how young people experience inclusivity, their parents and carers, and those we entrust to deliver their education, policy intention versus practice, as the convener set out in her contribution today. And indeed, when Angela Morgan published her report back in 2020, she was clear that her recommendations were not a quick fix and that cultural change to deliver improvement on the ground for children and young people would take time. Today, 37% of all pupils in Scotland have an additional support need, and in some schools, estimates are as high as 50%. To compare, when Angela Morgan published her review back in June of 2020, just over 30% of the school-age population were recorded as having an additional support need. Back in 2010, it was only 10%. Now, I don't believe these young people have simply appeared overnight. Indeed, I am firmly of the view that they have always been a key part of Scotland's education system. Perhaps we are better now at acknowledging that, though undoubtedly part of the shift is also down to the way that we now record statistics. Irrespective, there can be no doubt that the overall level of need continues to grow and that the complexity of need is changing, particularly post-pandemic, as the committee has heard. The education landscape continues. Yes, I will do so.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for taking that intervention. And does it concern the Cabinet Secretary then that the number of specialist teachers for pupils with additional support needs has gone down in that period?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, and I'm sure we'll come on to hear responses from members in relation to that point, but I'm sure the member will also recognise we now have record numbers of pupil support assistants in Scotland schools as a direct result of investment from this government. So in the last financial year alone, we have seen 725 more pupil support assistants in Scotland schools, but I take the member's point in relation to specialist staff. That education landscape, presiding officer, continues to evolve as we've seen a significant shift in the context within which we now deliver education, as I referenced in last week's statement on qualification reform. Children and young people with social, emotional and behavioural issues are now the largest population of pupils with additional support needs. And we know from the Behaviour in Scotland Schools research that schools are dealing with a wider variety of challenges than they perhaps would have faced 4 or 5 years ago. And that financial context, which we debated not 2 weeks ago during Conservative Party time, is having a direct impact on the choices the government in Scotland is able to make. But it is also worthwhile pointing out that it is within that challenging context that we have protected and increased funding for additional support needs. I know that the committee considered this issue, and I appreciate that Audit Scotland are carrying out further work on spend, which I will believe will be really helpful in addressing the other portfolios and areas of our public services, which also make a contribution to ASN spend. Presiding officer, under this government, spending on additional support for learning by authorities has reached a record high of £926 million in the last financial year. We also have the highest level of pupil support assistance on record, 17,330, an increase of more than 2,000 since 2020. And this additionality protected by government is helping our schools respond to the individual needs of our children and young people and those who are most vulnerable. The recommendations from the Morgan Review are being directly implemented through the Additional Support for Learning Action Plan. And the plan details the actions to be taken at national and local level to address the challenges raised and to support the necessary shift in culture, leadership and values across the education system. We have already progressed over half of those actions, with 40 of the 76 actions currently delivered. We have published 2 progress reports to date, and we will publish the 3rd progress report together with an updated action plan by the end of October. Education Scotland's work through their collaborative improvement visits with ADES is one example of the progress we have made. All local authorities in Scotland are engaged, and 7 include a focus on ASL. The information from these reports is currently being made available through the National Improvement Hub on Additional Support for Learning. Another example is the work currently underway with Scotland's councils to establish parent groups of those who have children with additional support needs. We know that this will support enhanced collaboration and communication on additional support for learning, a key issue which the committee considered. And that will be for parents and carers through the Learning Together National Action Plan, which was published back in 2023, will look to support further that work in relation to communication. And of course, professional learning opportunities for our teachers and our support staff continue to be a real priority. We know that there is more than one approach to addressing the issue of staff training, and I note the committee did not have a universal view on the use of mandatory training on ASN. Nonetheless, we remain committed to exploring options regarding initial teacher education. And to that end, I've asked my officials to conduct a short analysis of learning hours attributed to ASN support specifically within ITE across all of our initial teacher education providers. It's really important that we understand within government the level of support being given to teachers as they begin their journey into the profession. The committee's recommendations cover a wide range of issues, some of which are directed towards Scottish Government for action, some which sit with other partners such as local authorities, and that collaboration will be really key to progressing all of our existing areas of work. And it is important to remember, as I know committee members will, that often powers for educational improvement do not rest with central government, they rest with local authorities. Now, I have indicated to the committee that where we intend to strengthen aspects of the ASL Action Plan, we will deliver on the committee's asks. To that end, the updated ASL Action Plan, as I mentioned, will publish in the coming weeks. I hope that the committee members will be able to take note of that progress and engagement that the plan has responded to through their really important work.
Will the Minister give
me? Yes, I will.
Willie Rennie.
The Minister's given, quite a calm defence of her government's record on this, but that's not what we got from parents and young people. They're angry, they're fizzing, that years and years of talk has resulted in them being treated in this isolated way. So how much energy is the Minister putting into this? Because our calm presentation is fine, it's professional, but that's not what the parents and children are feeling.
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Mr Rennie for his intervention, and of course I note through the evidence the committee took the real strength of feeling from parents and carers and from young people. A large part of my work as Education Secretary is to go out almost on a weekly basis into schools and to listen to that strength of feeling. So I very much recognise often the emotion that is behind some of the frustration that parents feel, particularly when they're not able to access services that they should be entitled to. So as I am presenting the government's calm and rational response to the committee's recommendations, as I think is the correct way to address this, I do not doubt the strength of feeling, and I'm very much focused on delivering improvements to that end. It's also why I should say, Presiding Officer, I paused the update of the ASL Action Plan to listen to the committee, and I will also be listening today to members' responses such as Mr Rennie to make sure we drive the improvements that he spoke to. The convener, Presiding Officer, mentioned communications, and they're a really key theme which runs through the work of the Project Board as well as the committee inquiry. And the next phase of the ASL Action Plan will look to prioritise that need to improve accessibility of communications for all. I think, to Mr Rennie's point, that has been a key frustration that the committee has heard from parents, has really fed into some of the emotive response the committee has taken evidence on. And as members will know, I've also committed to updating the Code of Practice, which will also address a number of the committee's recommendations. We're working collaboratively with a range of education partners to ensure that guidance supports teachers and school staff in meeting the needs of our young people. A public consultation will further provide opportunity for stakeholder feedback. I will write to the committee once a date for that has been agreed, which I expect to be early next year. And finally, the next phase of work will also prioritise the National Measurement Framework. Success is different for everyone, and we must celebrate all learners' achievements, as we heard, of course, last week. Presiding Officer, I welcome the committee's inquiry on additional support for learning. It is a timely and a necessary inquiry, and this contribution sits within a wider landscape of a Scottish education system much changed by the COVID pandemic. I know that context that we are working in is challenging. However, I truly believe that if we continue to work in partnership, we can support all children and young people to reach their full potential. And it is in that spirit that I look forward to hearing the perspectives and thoughts of committee members across the chamber today. Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. And I call on Liam Kerr, around 8 minutes. Mr Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Additional Support for Learning Inquiry Report is a very serious document, and I commend my committee colleagues, the Parliament staff, and especially all those who submitted their views and appeared before committee to help us. The inquiry was launched to consider how the 2004 Education Act and the Presumption of Mainstreaming from 2000 Act are working, and it's not before time. Because there's been an extraordinary increase in the need for additional support in Scottish schools. The Cabinet Secretary gave percentages, but I think the figures are even starker, around 260,000 individuals in 2023, up from about 70,000 14 years ago. It's an increase that means that whilst many report feeling the Scottish Government has historically ignored this issue, now that nearly 40% of Scotland's pupils have some form of additional need, prevarication is not an option. In fact, given the conclusions of this report, 8 years after the latest amendment to the 2004 Act, 4 years on from the Morgan Review, some may consider prevarication to be a polite way of putting it. Because the committee's conclusion at paragraph 62 is stark. There was strong evidence to suggest that the majority of ASN pupils are not having their needs met. Not surprising, given the committee's finding that there is inconsistent implementation and application of principles across different local authorities, leading to an inconsistent experience for children, which is determined by where they live. We also found a consistent theme of inadequate funding and lack of resources for schools to properly support children with additional needs, which is only getting worse. And that in turn is stretching existing services and increasing pressure on what are already hard-pressed staff, exacerbated by existing challenges in availability, especially around specialists, which of course stands to reason, which, to put a number on Pam Duncan-Glancy's important intervention earlier, shows that there are over 600 fewer ASN teachers now than there were in 2010. All of which leads to inconsistencies in additional needs being identified, with some people being missed or only identified following the experiencing of significant challenges at school, leading ultimately to a situation where the policy of mainstreaming is broadly supported, but as the Commission on School Reform, the Govan Law Centre, Unison Scotland, amongst others, said to us, there is a huge gap between policy intention and delivery. But the committee has proposed solutions, which include better resourcing and training for teachers and staff, enhanced collaboration between education, health, social services to ensure comprehensive care will require 2 seconds, CabSec, improved data collection and monitoring to assess the effectiveness of ASL policies, increased awareness of parents' rights and clearer communication channels. However, we mustn't lose sight of the fact the Morgan report suggested much of this in 2020. So the fact that 4 years later the committee is finding much the same things under much the same government suggests this isn't being prioritised in the way we all think it should.
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for giving way. He mentioned staff training, and of course the committee, I think, took evidence in relation to staff training for pupil support assistants, but also for class teachers. I wonder if the member has a direct view on that. I appreciate the committee took a range of evidence on this topic, some advocating for mandatory training, others sitting in a different space. And he will also have heard in my contribution that we are going to audit the number of hours that our ITE providers provide in relation to ASN. It would be helpful to hear his views on that and any other ideas he may have in terms of how we can provide a more consistent offer of staff training for both teachers and pupil support assistants.
Liam Kerr, I'll give you the
time back. The very fact we're having this conversation is productive because I think the government recognises the importance of that extra training, and indeed it's something that we've recognised for a very long time. In our manifesto for the last election, we actually talked about ensuring initial teacher training, which would fully prepare all teachers to identify and support children with things like dyslexia and autism. So that was its core to our manifesto offering. And that core nature of it, that need for prioritisation of this area, I'm afraid I think is not being something that the government is taking seriously enough. And that's borne out by the response from the government and to the proposed solutions by the committee. You see, the government response claims the Scottish Government is fully committed to ensuring those with additional support needs are supported to live their lives to the fullest, despite the committee's report suggesting entirely the contrary. It goes on, the government's response. That's why we have a highly inclusive legislative framework in place which enables early learning, childcare and school settings to address any barriers to learning. But the committee's report suggests it enables nothing of the sort. And Willie Rennie's intervention was spot on. There has to be an honesty about what is going on here. And I worry about the fact that in its 27-page response, in characteristic fashion, the government either lauds past funding decisions and proudly states the inputs without interrogating or assessing the outputs or the KPIs being achieved or not, something the Cabinet Secretary just did in her remarks, or it pushes responsibility onto what the Scottish Government describes as its partners, such as COSLA, Education Scotland, the universities and so on. And when not slopey shouldering onto the partners, it talks about what the ASL Project Board might do. Now, many outside may be unfamiliar with this board, which was set up in October 2020 with a remit to deliver the ASL Action Plan by March 2026. But that lack of familiarity is no surprise, because if we assume the ASL Project Board duly met as was intended on the 12th September 2024, given the minutes of its 31st of July meeting were only uploaded on the 20th of September, people will remain unfamiliar for some time. And that's a pity, because the Cabinet Secretary committed in her response to deliver a progress report on the ASL Action Plan. Now, that progress report was last discussed by the ASL Project Board on the 31st of July, when the Project Board were content to approve the progress report be presented to Scottish Government and COSLA decision makers for clearance. So perhaps the Cabinet Secretary can confirm in closing whether it's been so presented and when precisely the plan that I think she said would be presented in October will actually come before us. You see, Presiding Officer, in her remarks, the Cabinet Secretary also committed to a consultation on a refresh of the Supporting Children's Learning Code of Practice, but I can find no evidence of it commencing or when it will. She commits to a literature review on the relationship between masking and ASN. I can find no evidence of that happening. On the problems of delays that the committee identified, she said she would engage with Scottish Government partners such as COSLA and provide an update to the committee. I don't recall an update to the committee. And since I mentioned COSLA, their response to the committee was only received and published on Friday afternoon last week. Now, to be fair, the Cabinet Secretary's response runs to 28 pages and was given to us in July. COSLA's runs to 2 pages and fails to, for example, mention COSLA's opinion on the progress report on the ASL Action Plan. Now, I suspect that this was discussed at the latest ASL Project Board meeting, because COSLA co-chairs it. But I cannot be sure because the minutes of that meeting, as I said, are not yet published. And my concern is that in 2023, the minutes for September's ASL Project Board meeting were not published until the 21st of December. And I sincerely trust that we will not have to wait 3 months for the next update. Now, I said, Presiding Officer, in conclusion, a fortnight ago, during the Conservative debate on the SNP's axing of the school meals manifesto promise, that this is about priorities. The money is there to make good things happen. It's just that this government chooses its priorities. And in the 2 weeks since that debate, to add to the constitution budget being maintained at £347 million, whilst education is axed by £6.7 million and health by £115 million, we've seen a government whose First Minister prefers to go leafleting in Glasgow, that flies its net zero minister to New York on a trip which cost £70,000 last year and devotes significant legislative time to a bill on Scottish languages. Presiding Officer, this is one of the most serious matters affecting Scotland. And this report is a serious attempt to analyse what's going on and recommend solutions. Unfortunately, it seems this government is anything but serious about dealing with it. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Pam Duncan-Glancy. Around 7 minutes, Ms Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And firstly, let me apologise to yourself and the Chamber and make members aware that I have secured prior permission from the Presiding Officer to leave slightly early this afternoon. Presiding Officer, it is a great honour to open this debate on additional support for learning this afternoon, a subject that is close to my heart and an inquiry that I'm proud to have been part of. I believe, as many colleagues do, that every child has the right to education, every child has the right to reach their fullest potential, and every child has the right to equal access of opportunity. Article 29 of the UN Conventions on the Rights of the Child states that education must develop every child's personality, talents and abilities to the full. These are not just aspirations, but rights. And I know only too well how hard fought they are. Myself and my colleague committees know only too well. Committee colleagues know only too well how hard fought they are, because we heard. As a young woman, my life chances were put at risk significantly. My family and I spent an unquestionable amount of time and energy putting wrongs in the system right. If it wasn't for them, and it wasn't for the hard work of teachers and a government and a school that was on my side, and a mum, dad and sister who were relentless in their pursuit of opportunity and equality, including for me, I may not be here today. And that opportunity should be available to everyone. I'll take the intervention from Jeremy Balfour.
Jeremy Balfour.
I'm grateful to remember. Remember, agree that this report doesn't cover the children that don't make it to school, and we have a growing number of children that aren't even getting the opportunity to be there, and that the government are not dealing with that issue in an appropriate way either.
Pam Duncan-Glancy, and give you the time back for the intervention.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I thank my colleague Jeremy Balfour for that intervention. And attendance is, of course, a serious issue, and pupils with additional support needs are more likely not to attend than others as well. So this is a matter that I hope the government will take incredibly serious when they're responding to not just this report, but the other factors in attendance that we have had highlighted to us in recent weeks and months. Presiding Officer, it should never have been a fight. That it was, and that the committee heard that it still is and should be a sobering wake-up call. More than that, though, it must be a call to action. And I hope that is in the spirit in which the government will approach and act on the report before them. Because the reality is that for far too many young people in Scotland, their rights are not being upheld and their opportunities are limited. And we've heard already this afternoon from my colleagues Sue Webber, Liam Kerr and the Cabinet Secretary about some of the ways in which the committee has set out how difficult things are. Young people with additional support needs are being let down. They face numerous barriers in access to inclusive education, and I contend that the barriers are systemic. Only this morning we heard again in committee how the system works against pupils with additional support needs. The EIS and others told committee this morning that their members stand up for quality education every single day, and for that I want to thank them. But they don't have the help that they need from their government to support pupils with additional support needs as they should. They're rushed off their feet. The scaffolding around them, as well as around the young people, CAMHS, speech and language therapy, educational psychology to name a few, has all but gone. Systemic change is needed, and that needs political will. That, though, I fear, is lacking. And I'm afraid I could see it creeping in, as my colleague Willie Rennie has mentioned, in the government's response to the committee's report, in particular on coordinated support plans. The committee heard that people don't access coordinated support plans, which, crucially, are the only plan that gives them a statutory right to ask for help and support. The committee heard that people don't access these because they can't get the third-party involvement that is needed to qualify for them, the CAMHS, the speech and language therapy, the educational psychology, because of waiting lists, because this is no longer available. Instead of setting out what they'll do to address that serious concern that the committee have raised, the government have again said that implementation is the issue. And implementation is, of course, the issue, but on this, the matter is that the statutory code of practice and guidance need to be addressed in order to take account and drive forward the change that's needed. And we've heard this before from the government, that legislation isn't needed to resolve it. Indeed, I heard it with my own bill. And pupils and parents across the country just now will be listening and saying, heard it, we've heard it before. We need action, not warm words from the government. We just don't have enough pace. Because as we've heard, the number of pupils with additional support needs is going up, but support and the number of specialist teachers and the scaffolding around them, as I've said, has dropped dramatically. And with this, a disproportionate number of pupils with ASN come from disadvantaged backgrounds. Greater support from children from those areas is also needed to level the playing field of opportunity. There have been repeated calls from parents, teachers and support staff for change to be implemented. They're as angry as Willie Rennie has said they are, and they believe that talk isn't enough. People feel the government has sat back, they've let them down, they've refused to bring in necessary legislation to change the playing field. They've all and hid behind the implementation gap, but the reality is this is just not enough. The government commissioned Angela Morgan's review, and it published 4 years ago. And, Presiding Officer, I'm disappointed, to say the least, that little has moved on since then. The only real change we've seen in the system is more young people need support, teachers are having to do more with less support, and families are stressed out as they advocate for their children and young people. Helen Forrest, the Chief Executive of Children's Health Scotland, said, "It's shameful that the needs and rights of children and young people with additional support needs are still not being met." Pupils with additional support needs and meeting their needs must be a priority, not just because the committee found that there is a significant gap between the ambitions and implementation of mainstreaming, or that the situation was found to be intolerable, or because there are more children with additional support needs, but because we in this place and this government have a moral and legal duty to get this right. And I'm pleased that the report recognises the urgency with which the committee recommends deficiencies are addressed, and I hope the government will act with pace. Because as the committee report sets out, there is indeed a way forward. We can have an education system that promotes equal opportunity for all. If we listen and act, we can take teachers with us and support them to do the job they know they can do. We can have a system where pupils with additional support needs can leave school with a fighting chance. A system that gives them opportunity. And we know this will need change. Change that stops delays in provision of support. Change that sees greater clarity and clearer career pathways for staff supporting pupils. And change that puts parents, pupils and staff in school at its heart. Presiding Officer, in closing, people like me don't always get the same life chances as others. Some of us, with the help of a tenacious family, parents, teachers and a good government, buck the trend. But it's our job in this place to change that trend. Presiding Officer, it is our job to lift the class glass and step ceiling in the way of opportunity with a relentless focus on spreading it for every single young person in Scotland. That is the job of a world-leading education system, and that is one that we can begin to have again with a government that's willing to do it. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I now call Gillian Mackay, around 6 minutes. Ms Mackay.
Thanks, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I'd like to begin by echoing the thanks of others to the clerks, committee members and those who gave evidence to this inquiry. As most across the chamber will be well aware, and as the committee report highlights, in the last decade alone, the number of pupils across Scotland with a recognised additional support need has doubled. As we've developed a better understanding of additional support needs, the number of pupils in Scotland who are identified as in need of extra support has increased dramatically. But these numbers, of course, do not include pupils who may have an additional support need that has not yet been recognised for one reason or another and have slipped through the cracks of a system designed to support them. The number of pupils with a recognised additional support need jumping so wildly year to year is not only because of our greater understanding of these additional needs, but because of the disparity in reporting between local authorities. Presiding Officer, while many will be aware, I do not sit on the Education, Children and Young People Committee during the inquiry. I am impersonating Ross Greer today. I noted the contents of the report and submissions to the committee with great interest, many of which I'll come on to in due course, but one particular relating to my last point. The issue of when support can be put in place for a young person was highlighted in the committee's report, claiming that some local authorities are waiting for a formal ASN diagnosis before putting the necessary support in place, while in other areas that's not required but not communicated effectively to parents. This is then having a knock-on impact on accurate reporting. Of course, the only support available, as set out in law, are coordinated support plans, as we've already heard. But currently, just 0.5% of young people with a recognised ASN need have one, and that proportion is continually widening. We're hearing testimony more and more frequently through this inquiry and beyond that councils are not fully understanding what's required of them when it comes to CSPs, and that young people and parents have gone through experiences nothing short of traumatic because of the lack of a coordinated support plan. Presiding officer, coordinated support plans should play a critical role in enabling children to access the support they require to have their rights fulfilled, but the criteria for them is too narrow to be effective. Outlined in the Education Additional Support Needs Scotland 2004 Act, the current criteria places an outdated and restrictive view on the provision of CSPs by local authorities, which, if removed from primary legislation, I feel would ensure greater flexibility and adaptability to ensure CSPs work for individuals. I mean, yes, absolutely.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful for the member to take an intervention on that point, but following the UNCRC, shouldn't the Scottish Government be aware that their failure to address the concerns over the coordinated support plan merely opens up a different venue for young people to bring an action against a local authority or indeed the Scottish Government?
Gillian Mackay.
Yes, absolutely. And Mr. Whitfield is far more of an expert in that than me and makes the point well. A major barrier for young people accessing coordinated support plans is the requirement for a young person to need at least 12 months of intense support from multiple services. But when a young person who everyone agrees needs a coordinated support plan comes to get one, they're unable to because that one specific box could not be ticked. While not in the direct remit of education ministers, I believe an option to undertake such a change to the requirements for obtaining a coordinated support plan could sit within the proposed Learning, Disability, Autism and Neurodiversity Bill, and would welcome confirmation from the Government as to whether it considers that an amendment of this nature would be in scope. It's disappointing to not see this bill contained in the latest programme for Government, but I welcome reassurances from both the Minister for Social Care, Mental Wellbeing and Sport and the Minister for Children and Young People that work on the provisions of the bill is underway and hope to see the publication of a bill as soon as possible. Presiding officer, my Scottish Green colleagues and I stand firm in the belief that education must be inclusive, where every young person can thrive. But what the committee report highlights is that Scotland's education system, while largely well-intentioned, is failing to deliver the inclusive vision that it set out to achieve. The failure is particularly evident when we look at the lack of adequate resourcing and support staff. Teachers and support workers are often overwhelmed by the growing demands in classrooms, and the committee has heard from witnesses who describe the increasing complexity of pupils' needs. Yet the level of specialist support, whether it's access to speech and language therapy, as we've heard already, educational psychologists or mental health services, is simply not keeping pace. The vast majority of pupils with additional support needs can and should be supported within mainstream schools with the right resources. But for young people with very high levels of additional needs, education providers for those with complex needs will continue to provide the most appropriate education environment. But as witness after witness evidence, the implementation of mainstreaming has been problematic while not properly resourced. As the committee report highlights, children with more complex needs are increasingly being placed in mainstream settings without the appropriate support. This is setting them up to fail, and it's putting immense pressure on teachers who are not equipped to manage these diverse and complex needs without the right training and resources. In closing, Presiding Officer, I'm sure there'll be a lot of talk this afternoon about the lack of resourcing in this debate, and I recognise that it would be inappropriate of me to come to this discussion demanding more and more from Government while the Cabinet Secretary's budget is becoming tighter and tighter. But while I recognise the challenges of funding such a system, there must be greater scrutiny on how current spending priorities across government might be rebalanced to better support young people. There's a wide array of wasteful spending that government continues to pursue. In the education space, one saving, albeit a small one, would be to end national standardised assessments. In other areas, there's around £4 million worth of tax breaks for shooting estates, for example, and there are other tax breaks for large, highly profitable organisations, which would be a good place to start to reallocate money. The education portfolio does bear a disproportionate burden of in-year budget balancing exercises because, unlike many other portfolios, it does have areas of spending that can be reallocated each year. However, the collective impact of that over the past few years has been disproportionate and is having an impact not only on tackling rising issues with behaviour in schools and the provision of universal school meals, but also, crucially, on the support that can be offered to the ever-rising number of young people in Scotland with additional support needs.
Thank you. I now call Willie Rennie, around 6 minutes. Mr Rennie.
I'm in awe of the committee clerks that they are able to write such a coherent and powerful report from our various ramblings in the committee, but also the really powerful witnesses, emotional, angry witnesses who come forward, and they're able to transcribe that into a very effective report that I think has really struck at the heart of the government. I received some information from the National Autistic Society. They carried out a survey of pupils, parents and teachers, and while there was support for mainstreaming, an even higher percentage of 81% said that Scotland does not have a fully inclusive education system. And this one particular quote was especially powerful. "My son was trapped in mainstream and didn't cope even with full one-to-one support, which was provided by several teaching assistants borrowed from different classes, from different year groups at different times of the day and the week. They had no training or real understanding of autism or dyspraxia. And in his time at mainstream school, my son was taught at a desk at the back of the stage in the hall with very little teacher input." Now, that's a recent experience, and that's something that should shame us. We're supposed to have a fully inclusive system, but this young man was taught at the back of the hall by a range of pupil support assistants from a variety of different classes at different times with no specialist training. That should not be happening. And I think that colours this whole report, and it brings a stark contrast with, I think, what we sometimes celebrate as being able to identify more and more people who have got specialist needs. But if we don't address those specialist needs, there is little point in identifying them. We can celebrate that till the cows come home, but if we actually don't do anything about it, all we're doing is setting them up to fail. And that was the conclusion of our report. Parents, I meet a lot of parents who've got young people, sometimes older people with additional specialist learning requirements, and they fight all of their life, and they are brilliant at it. They are really effective at making the authorities listen. But they shouldn't have to put so much effort into that, because the system should be there helping them rather than providing barriers. But they do this all of their life. Now, we have had the Morgan Review, we've got legislation, we've got GIRFIC, we've got policies and legislation coming out of our ears. But the actual real impact on the ground is very limited. The 1 in 3, more than that now, of pupils in a typical class will have some kind of need. Now, I've talked about the pupil experience. The teacher experience is just as challenging. How are they supposed to cope with a huge, wide range of needs within the class? Because this is not a homogenous group of young people. They have got a variety of different needs that require a variety of different specialists and training to deal with. But how are these teachers supposed to cope with that huge variation? And there was some talk about mandatory training. And one of the cautions that we had about pursuing the mandatory route for training was because the cohort is so wide and varied. The needs are so wide and varied, and they change. And they change from day to day, year to year. The knowledge, the understanding constantly changes, which is why the speech and language representatives who came and spoke to the committee were so powerful. They regretted the fact that they weren't in the class providing support, exchanging knowledge, making sure that practice can be brought up to speed. Rather than doing the teaching themselves, they were wanting to help the teachers deal with that particular pupil and their particular needs. And I thought that was a particularly powerful bit of evidence that was provided. So I do have caution about the mandatory training. Of course, we should have an awful lot more training. That should be, of course, a nature of the job. But the actual way that we deliver that needs to be bespoke to the individual young people within the class. Now, the Education Secretary, when she came before us on the committee, expressed Reservations about the current practice of building big, open-planned schools. And we heard direct evidence, I think it was from the National Autistic Society, who also expressed reservations about that. What I'm puzzled about, though, is how we have pursued this construction of new schools over many, many years, 17 years of this government, without this knowledge being shared with those who are designing the classes. It came as somewhat of a surprise to the Education Secretary that this was happening. But the very school in Fife that I know, in fact, they're combining two schools with a college in Fife to create a whopping big super campus. Huge big. And that was something that John Swinney insisted it happened, because the college weren't particularly keen on going down that route. So how on earth has been such a disconnect between what the Education Secretary believes now, which I have a sympathy with, and the previous practice of building colossal, whopping big schools, often the direction of the minister at the time? So I think there's been a disconnect, but we have built so many schools with this design in place that perhaps is not suitable for many young people, particularly who are neurodiverse. So I'd like to see what the Education Secretary is going to do in terms of the change of practice in that area, because we continue to build more schools and we continue to build schools that are perhaps not suitable for the young people. And I'll finish on this conclusion. Of course, resources are an issue. Of course they are. We need to make sure that we get the right resource into this area, and we need to look at reallocations. But it's not just about resources. It's about the practice as well. We need to make sure we've got the right teachers with the right training in the right place, with the right attitude and with the right support from leaders in education authorities, but also within the Scottish Government.
Thank you very much. We now move to the open debate. I call first Ruth Maguire to be followed by Jeremy Balfour, around 6 minutes. Ms Maguire.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I congratulate the Education, Children and Young Persons Convener on securing this debate and the committee for being true to their word and keeping a sustained focus on the experiences of children and young people with additional support for learning needs. As a former member of the committee who was involved in this work, I'd like to thank the children, young people and their adults who shared their experiences with us. The committee was fortunate to hear directly from the inclusion ambassadors who were supported by Children in Scotland on how it feels when their school gets support right. I appreciated how openly and generously they spoke of their experience of being a pupil with additional support needs, including what works and what could be made better. It feels right to share what they said with the Chamber. They told committee that pupils feel really good when the support provided is correct and suits their needs. They let us know that it was hard to understand when somebody doesn't give them the support they need. They highlighted that it does not work well when there are not enough support staff to cope with the number of pupils who need support, which can lead to pupils feeling frustrated. And I think to the point that Willie Rennie made about support staff being moved around, when every time that happens, a young person is missing out as a support staff member's moved elsewhere. So the committee met with young people, the inclusion ambassadors, as I said, parents, carers and teachers in informal participation sessions to ensure that we heard directly from those with personal experience and to really try and get a handle on the issues they were facing. The committee was extremely concerned by what we heard regarding the negative personal experiences of ASL provision, the implementation of the presumption of mainstreaming, and the detrimental impact that this has had on some pupils with ASN, their parents, and carers, teachers and support staff. It's important to say that the committee did recognise the excellent work being done by teachers and support staff, but were really concerned to hear of the pressures that they faced, pressures leaving them feeling overwhelmed and burnt out. The issue of resource was a frequent theme, not just in terms of numbers of staff and assistance to support children, but also in terms of flexibility to allow time for ongoing training and reflection on practice. Parents too also often described exhaustion with the fight that they faced in navigating systems to ensure that their children had the education that they were entitled to. There is no doubt in my mind that there is a gap between legislation and policy, which we have, which is excellent legislation and policy, and what children and young people are experiencing. The strength of feeling from this committee report should be really clear. When a cross-party committee report uses words such as intolerable, the government needs to take notice. If I may, I'll share an example of a bit of work from my own local authority area. I had the pleasure of helping facilitate discussions and actions between ASN Support Ayrshire, who are a parents group, and North Ayrshire Council. ASN Support Ayrshire had reached out to me. Parents were expressing their struggle to access support for their children, again, support they were entitled to. They really felt their opinions were not being valued, that they weren't being heard by schools, and that communications were becoming really challenging. When I raised this with the local authority, they were very open to meeting and discussing things. And myself and a representative from ASN Support Ayrshire, the Executive Manager for Inclusion and Child Protection, and the Principal Educational Psychologist had productive discussions. Training, parental engagement, communication, the E19 process, masking, and areas of excellent practice were all spoken about. A suggested improvement to the E19 process was accepted around parents being able to see the report submitted to the inclusion group and ensuring that all parents were aware they could submit a statement and any additional information they felt was pertinent. The Council also shared their proposed new literature with ASN Support Network for their feedback. Monthly meetings and ongoing collaboration are planned. The committee report states that improvements can be made to current practice without incurring additional cost. I think what I've just described is quite a good example of that. And I'm very hopeful that these actions will make a difference to how parents are experiencing their journey with children through the education system. The committee report recognises where systems need to improve. It is as important to understand where things are working well as it is to know where there are challenges. The importance of this as we move forward is that where an implementation gap exists, where people are being failed despite good policy, despite perhaps world-leading legislation, more legislation, more structural change may not be what's required to make things better for people. And I think in this place we have to be vigilant that we're not just labelling whole systems as broken. In this and in previous committee inquiries, it's been clear that some of the best practice and results for children and young people were more about culture than about legislation. There is some learning in that for all of us, and for children and young people in Scotland, it's a lesson that we really need to learn very quickly, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much. And I call Jeremy Balfour to be followed by Stuart McMillan again, around 6 minutes. Mr. Balfour.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm sure my colleagues will be aware there's a strong feeling that disabled issues are not being taken seriously in this Parliament. There's been a distinct lack of action this session, and with two disability bills kicked into the long grass, 10 million stolen from changing place toilets, there are many individuals and organisations are rightly feeling let down. I am, however, grateful to the Education and Young People's Committee for their work on this report, and I do hope that it can spark meaningful action that will improve the lives of disabled children in our schools. Presiding Officer, I had a very positive upbringing. I had supportive parents who fought hard to ensure that I didn't lack any opportunity on the basis of my disability. I attended mainstream classes during my whole education and was being able to be involved in various different activities. Up until 2016, I believed that I'd had a fairly normal experience. Since being elected, I have seen more and more evidence that mainstreaming is not the gold standard solution that it perhaps has been seen in the past. I agree with the committee's findings that a presumption of mainstreaming is a positive thing. However, I do believe that in many cases we have gone too far, forcing children into classes that are not suited for them to make sure that they and their peers will fail. The reality is that for many children, a mainstream class will never be suitable for them. That's okay. We have to accept that alternative education pathways are not a sign of failure, but rather success in supporting an individual's learning. Whether the pathway is of the utmost importance that we ensure that the right resources are in place to support those that need it. I note that during the oral evidence the committee heard from a Salveston Mind Room Centre, there are many cases where a child is in mainstream school, the school cannot provide adequate support, and it can be a real struggle for parents to secure specialist provision. We cannot allow this to continue. No one can provide high-quality education without the necessary funding and resources, regardless of the additional needs of the class. If mainstream is to work, we have to have ASN teachers in the classroom with the financial support that we need. That comes down to resourcing of local government, and we cannot run away from the fact that without the money, children will fail. Recognising this, Presiding Officer, it is equally important that we ensure special school places are readily available for those who require them. Again, I understand the committee heard during oral evidence that places can be hard to come by, and there are a number of children with additional support needs who do not have any provision in their local area. This, of course, is unacceptable, and I am pleased to see the committee has recommended that local authority assesses what specialist provision is currently in place to address any gaps in provision as a matter of urgency. Presiding Officer, I want to draw attention to the fact that there is a tendency to act as though once someone who requires additional support needs has its place or her place in a class, whether mainstream or not, that this is the end of the story. On the contrary, we should recognise that additional support needs are not set in stone and can change due to too many different factors. Just because a solution is appropriate at one moment doesn't mean it will be appropriate for the whole of that educational period. Sometimes a child will be happy in mainstream class for a while, but then their needs change to an extent where a special class might be more appropriate. The journey continues, and we should be ready to adapt where needed. We must have a system that is comprehensive enough to ensure that all children can have a solution that fits their needs, flexible enough to deal with the fact that those needs can change. To conclude, Presiding Officer, this is not a theoretical discussion. This is not just a debate to fill in a Wednesday afternoon. I've been approached by a constituent whose child has just finished primary school. They attended 2 days a week, and for those 2 days, they were educated in the hall outside the classroom with one support teacher. At best, they got 10 minutes a week with other children to play with. We are dealing with real people from whom this is a real issue. Recently, at an event in this Parliament, we heard from parents of young people with autism who are thinking about committing suicide because of the state of their education today in Scotland. This is a shame on all of us and is unacceptable. And yet the cost-cutting actions sometimes proposed by local authorities, including officers here in Edinburgh City Council, are contributing to this dire situation. I hope that we can all treat this topic with the seriousness it deserves going forward, and collectively we take it much more seriously and actually bring about change. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Balfour. I now call Stuart McMillan to be followed by Alec Riley. Mr McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First of all, I want to thank the Education, Children and Young People Committee for undertaking this work and producing this hugely important report. This report is something I very much support. It was timely for me as a local MSP due to the increasing number of constituents who have raised issues facing children with additional support needs. Initially, some of the initial issues that were raised with me were regarding Inverclyde Council's Play for All scheme, which aims to provide affordable childcare during the summer holidays for children with ASN. But quickly, many more issues came to the fore. Due to the demand, several children were not granted a place, leaving families without any viable childcare option over the summer period and leading to some parents having to take unpaid leave to be at home with their child. Now, for those whose child was granted a place on a scheme, many told me that they were offered 4 hours of childcare for a whole 6-week holiday period. Now, understandably, this was entirely unworkable for most families, as they said that the disruption to their child's routine for those 4 hours wasn't worth sending them. And one other point that came throughout the discussions was the length of time that when the children went back to school after the summer holiday break, that extended period of time it would take for the children to then settle back into the schooling situation. So the 4 hours certainly was nowhere near enough to assist with that aspect either. Presiding Officer, I raised these concerns with Inverclyde Council, and they themselves recognised that the improvements needed to be made to the Play for All scheme. Now, sadly, though, as the committee report highlights, and as colleagues from across the chamber have already indicated, there are broader systematic challenges that children and young people with ASN face. I've shared this report with the recently established group called the ASN Parent and Carer Support Group Inverclyde. Now, after seeing the group advertise activities for families in Inverclyde with ASN children, I reached out to them, as was pleased to see that this offering being made given the challenges with the Play for All situation locally. That upon meeting several of the parents who had been attending the group sessions, it was clear to me that there remains a huge gap in the ASN childcare provision within Inverclyde. Families noted that various local facilities do offer ASN-friendly services such as Waterfront Cinema and several of the soft play centres, and they were happy to pay for this. However, the issue remained that, and the issue that they came to me with initially, that the issue was that the summer holiday childcare options available to children with ASN are not on a par with the package offered to neurotypical children, as funded play schemes for neurotypical children were offering days and weeks worth of childcare. One of the big frustrations around this as well was the fact that there's a school in Port Glasgow which is considered to be one of the best schools for children with ASN, but over the summer period is closed. And here was a resource that actually could be utilised to actually help children. So I organised a roundtable meeting involving members of the ASN Parent and Carer Support Inverclyde Group and local councillors to discuss the myriad of issues from childcare to schooling that impacts children with ASN. And section 29 of this report states, and others have touched upon kind of the word fight, but I think the whole section is really important in this aspect, and that's that many responses to the call for views contain details of negative personal experiences, including parents and carers having to fight to get support for their child, and some disturbing accounts of the impact on children and young people with ASN's health and mental well-being. Now, sadly, this very much reflects the feelings and experiences of the families that I have spoken to and met in Inverclyde. In fact, so many of the experiences faced by local families reflect that of families across Scotland. Now, the Morgan Review has already been touched upon. It was published in 2020, which considered the post-legislative landscape for additional support for learning. And the convener very much spoke about this in her opening comments. And I agree with Angela Morgan's position that our recommendations were not a quick fix, and that cultural change to deliver improvements to ASL implementation and to ensure meaningful change for children and young people will take time. We've already seen that cultural change can happen when we consider the issue of stigma around mental health. Over the course of the last 15 years, society has changed greatly in this regard, and I welcome the fact society has changed in that, because it does mean that more people are coming forward seeking the help and assistance that they need. In the situation that we're discussing today, that is very much an issue that will take a bit of time, but we have to attempt to lead with regards to policies, but also leadership in that regard. So I am pleased that the Scottish Government will update the Additional Support for Learning Action Plan, reflecting the relevant recommendations of the committee's report, and the Cabinet Secretary spoke about the third update later on this year. And it's something I will certainly look forward to reading. As I begin to conclude, Presiding Officer, I think it's worth noting that there have been some improvements that have taken place. First of all, there are 17,330 pupil support staff in Scotland. That's the highest level on record, and an increase of more than 2,000 since 2020. There's also the work with regards to the map of how ASL policy stretches across the education, health and social care sectors to ensure that we can work across boundaries to deliver better support. But there is still so much more to do. One final point, Presiding Officer. I do want once again to thank the committee for producing this important report and for keeping ASN on the agenda to help many households and children who need the support. Crucially, parents. Parents only want to have the best life chances for their children. Parents of ASN children are absolutely no different in that regard. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. McMillan. I now call Alec Rowley to be followed by Bill Kidd. Mr. Rowley.
Sir, the additional support for learning inquiry that the committee undertook and the discussion we are having today is crucial if we are to understand some of the big issues that schools, pupils, parents and staff are facing in Scottish education at this time. My own view is that this inquiry and report has highlighted a range of key issues that must be addressed, and as well as thanking the committee for their work, I would also thank those who gave evidence that has provided a wide range of knowledge and experience of what is actually happening on the ground. I suspect the big question on the minds of those who gave evidence, on the minds of the school community and on the minds of parents up and down the country will be, what now? Will this report lead to actions to address the issues that have been raised? I know in responding to the report, the Education Secretary stated, and I quote, "Scottish education has an inclusive ethos, and over the past 20 years we have made extensive policy and legislative changes to enable those with additional support needs to thrive as part of their class, their school and their wider community." Unison, in their written submission, acknowledges the point about the level of legislation and strategy and policy when they state there are some good strategic and policy papers around supporting children. But they then go on to say these have not been matched with the adequate funding to enable their implementation or recruitment, training and support for the staff in order to ensure that they can deliver the correct support. So the point that I would make is you can have the very best of policy, strategy papers and put that into legislation, but if you then fail to put in place the necessary levels of resource, those policies and strategies will not succeed. Now, the report highlights a range of issues where there needs to be improvement. These include poor communications with families, the disproportionate number of children with additional support needs being excluded, the call for greater flexibility of learning for pupils with additional support needs, the transition from primary to secondary school and indeed into adulthood, the requirement for public services to work more closely in partnership, the need for continuous professional learning and development training for teachers and learning support staff, the need for guidance on school buildings and the built-up environment, the need to review specialist school provision, the difficulty that parents find and pupils find to get the correct support. These are just some of the key issues that must be addressed if we're serious about making this report count. And these are issues that can and should be addressed across a range of professional services provided in the public sector. But can I suggest this needs overall leadership and drive? And in my view, such drive and leadership must come from the Scottish Government. And I would also suggest this will also require more focused funding. The committee, I know, asked the Government to do more work so that we can quantify the level of expenditure being allocated to additional support for learning. And they also go on to ask Audit Scotland to consider undertaking audit work on this cross-cutting spending, and I hope again that's something that will be picked up. I do believe this is required in order that informed decisions can be made around the financial requirements to deliver on the policies, the strategies and the legislation for additional support learning in Scotland. The point that Unison made in their submission I would reiterate. They said, overall, our response is summed up by saying that while we support mainstreaming in principle, it must be sufficiently funded. While there will be some very good practice going on in some schools, it is currently not working well for far too many children, those with identified additional support needs and other pupils. Despite the best efforts of dedicated teaching and support staff and other education professionals, they do not have sufficient resources and support to deliver the quality learning experience all pupils deserve. They said while we and our members regularly highlight the understaffing and under-resourcing, we see no signs of major improvements, particularly given the huge constraints on local government finance. Indeed, they add, cuts are putting immense additional pressure on council spending, and they highlight cuts to budgets for additional supported learning and education psychologists, with flat rate funding having been put forward last year. Spending on mental health services are also being cut at a time when there remain serious concerns about mental health waiting lists, including access to child and adolescent mental health services. They also say access to such services can be patchy and the link with schools is often a postcode lottery. We must see a far more joined up approach to mental health for children and young people if we are serious about making the kind of changes that this report calls for. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Riley. And I now call Bill Kitt. Mr. Kitt.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And I'd like to begin by thanking also all those who contributed to the inquiry, parents, carers, teachers, and especially the young people. Their voices are essential to this report and its recommendations. I welcome the fact that the report has been positively received by the Scottish Government and that they have committed to updating the ASL Action Plan in line with recommendations. We all know the challenges faced, and I believe the Government is sincere in its determination to meet these challenges. The Morgan Review in 2020 set a clear direction for the progress that can be made in the ASL. While the legislative framework is solid, the real challenge lies in translating those principles into effective practice. I think the Government recognises that there is still work to be done and is committed to ensuring that inclusive policies are realised in every classroom, which is what is required. Angela Morgan's recommendations are not a quick fix, but they offer a roadmap for a meaningful and lasting change. It's essential that we embed support for all children and young people as early as possible. And that is why we have a highly inclusive legislative framework in place covering early learning, childcare and school settings. The Government's approach is anchored in getting it right for every child, or GIRFEC, and it looks to ensure that no child is left behind. This isn't about additional support as an afterthought, and it mustn't be. It's about creating an education system that actively removes barriers to learning. The pandemic intensified challenges in our schools, from attendance to behaviour, and young people are still feeling the effects of disrupted learning. We all recognise this, and our focus must remain on building a system that responds to such challenges. Importantly, we have also seen a significant increase in the number of learners requiring additional support. This reaffirms the need for a whole system approach to inclusivity. ASL is not a side issue. It touches every part of our education, health and social care sectors, and that's why we must map how ASL policy spans these areas to better coordinate services for young people and their families. The principle of mainstreaming must remain fundamental to our approach. We have made extensive legislative and policy changes over the last 20 years to help children with additional support needs to realise their potential in classrooms, schools and in their communities. However, we must recognise that mainstreaming is not without its challenges, as has been said. For some children, specialist environments are more appropriate, and we must remain flexible in ensuring all pupils get the support that best meets their needs. We also acknowledge the financial pressures on our education system, exacerbated by austerity and the pandemic. Despite these challenges, the Scottish Government continues
investing in young people. And in 2022-23, local authority spending on ASL reached a record high of £926 million. That included an annual investment of £15 million for councils and £11 million specifically for supporting pupils with complex additional needs. In terms of staffing, we now have 17,330 pupil support staff in Scotland, an increase of over 2,000 since 2020. This reflects ongoing commitment, I'm pleased to say, to ensuring that teachers and support staff have the resources they need to try and deliver the best outcomes for every child. On this note, Presiding Officer, I recently received correspondence from a constituent concerned over Glasgow City Council's decision to remove the head teacher from one of my local primary schools with little notice and the effect that this is having on pupils, particularly those with additional support needs. Alarmingly, my constituent has been told by the school, somewhat disingenuously in my view, that funding for one of their pupil support assistants was removed as a result of the announcement not to extend free school meals to all primary age children at this time. Doesn't make much sense to me. And whilst I will write directly to the Cabinet Secretary on this particular constituent issue, I wonder if it would be possible for this to be correct, in my view, apparent misconception being promoted by the school. As we know, the ASL Action Plan will be updated alongside a progress report this autumn, reflecting the committee's recommendations and the changing educational landscape. And I very much look forward to this report with keen interest. The ASL Project Board will also continue to play a crucial role in ensuring that policy evolves to meet the emerging needs of our young people. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I don't pretend that there aren't real challenges here or that more must and can be done. However, as I've said, I believe that the Government is sincere in its commitment to take forward the significant recommendations set out in the committee's report, and I, for one, look to holding them to this commitment. Mainstreaming, inclusivity and ASL are not just goals, they are principles that shape the kind of Scotland we all want to see. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Kidd. We will now move to closing speeches, and it is regrettable that we do not have the committee convener for closing speeches when it is a committee debate. And I call Gillian Mackay to close on behalf of Scottish Greens. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. One of the more striking concerns raised during the committee's inquiry is the challenge faced by parents when trying to navigate the complex and often opaque systems designed to support young people. In my opening speech, I spoke about the role that coordinated support plans should play, but Scotland's education system is not one where parents and young people should have to fight to get information about their rights, not least in a country which has enshrined the UNCRC into law. At present, many local authorities make it difficult for parents to engage with support services, but one easy remedy would be for an obligation to be placed on councils to proactively inform parents about their rights and clearly signpost next steps in relation to needs assessments, transition plans and support plans. Simple steps like timely communication and available options would empower parents, reduce stress and ensure early intervention where it's needed most. But in some circumstances, this isn't always enough. For example, I'm currently supporting families in North Lanarkshire who are having a hard time just getting transport to get their children to school who have an additional support need as a result of a cut in bus entitlement. For some families, getting their children to school is a barrier to their education as a whole. And this decision was clearly one in which children with an additional support need were not taken, but who were in mainstream school didn't factor into the decision. Many could tolerate the school bus and were relatively safe in this relatively controlled environment, but the service bus is not appropriate for them. And as far as we can find, there was no outreach to these parents or young people about the impact on them. But, Presiding Officer, from that example alone, just improving communication clearly isn't a cure-all. Even with the best of intentions, informing parents and young people of their rights does little good if the support services or schools they are in are overwhelmed. despite a recurring £145 million intervention delivered by Scottish Greens during our time in government, many local authorities failed to utilise this cash for the desired purpose of transferring temporary teacher contracts to permanent ones. This has sadly resulted in the number of teachers across Scotland falling, and unfortunately, all indicators point towards teacher numbers continuing to fall. Less teachers, particularly those specialising in additional support needs, while the number of pupils continues to rise, is a recipe for burnout and an overwhelmed system. I was proud to see two particular commitments focusing on increased staff levels for those with additional support needs brought into government through the Bute House Agreement. The first was to develop a programme of accreditation and registration for additional support needs assistance. The second, to work with the SNCT to ensure there's appropriate career progression and pathways for teachers looking to specialise in additional support for learning. Progress on the first of these two commitments seemed to be progressing positively, albeit delayed, but since the Greens left the room, we've heard nothing from the government. The second, a commitment also contained in the Additional Support for Learning Action Plan, also seemingly stalled. The last update to the ASL Action Plan was published in November 2022, and despite an initial government commitment to review the plan in spring of this year, I'm glad to hear confirmation that a further update is due soon, and I would be particularly keen, as I'm sure my colleague Ross Greer would, to hear the Cabinet Secretary either in closing or in writing an update on both of these commitments, and would also be happy to contribute to the upcoming refresh of the ASL Action Plan. We recognise the scale of the challenge that's faced by government, but that cannot be met with inaction. It's clear that targeted investment in teacher training and career progression, as well as the expansion of multi-agency support within schools, is crucial to tackling the problems that are faced in implementing mainstreaming and access to support. In the spirit of collegiality, we remain committed to the delivery of these promises and would be happy to work with the government on delivering them. One area in which I'm glad we are making progress and that will have a positive knock-on effect is the provision of mental health support services in schools, which guarantee access in school to mental health wellbeing and support. We're certainly far from being in a position where every child has equal access to these services, but the past 3 6-monthly reports have shown a steady increase in children and young people accessing these expanded services. However, reporting for the last 3 periods published by the government came at the end of 2022, and no such further reports by the government have been forthcoming. And again, we'd be very interested in any updated reporting on this. I was also interested in the comments from Jeremy Balfour around anything other than mainstreaming for a young person being seen as a failure. One thing I often don't hear being discussed is how we make sure that young person can find where the best place is for them. We've spoken about various plans, reviews, support plans, and I'm amazed that parents actually know where to start. And setting aside the current issues with resource and mainstream in terms of culture, we need to be able to offer both mainstream and additional support settings as equal options. And as Jeremy Balfour noted, being able to move between them depending on a change in the child or young person's needs, and crucially, that support following that young person. Presiding Officer, it is important that we don't see these issues as individual, with specific and tailored responses to each. The solution to properly addressing additional support needs and wider issues is to view all of these in a holistic nature. If we are serious about ensuring a fair education for all, we must ask ourselves how we can reconcile our commitment to inclusion and support for ESN pupils with the fact that classrooms are increasingly crowded and teachers are overwhelmed. I hope that the Education, Children and Young People's Report will be a significant stepping stone to achieving that vision.
Thank you, Ms Mackay. I now call on Martin Whitfield to close on behalf of Scottish Labour. Up to 6 minutes, please.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, and it is a privilege to close this debate on behalf of Scottish Labour. And before doing so, I just want to echo Pam Duncan-Glancy's apology for not being here at the end of the debate. I would like to start, as many have done, by thanking both the committee but also those that gave evidence to the committee. But I would also like to thank the committee for going out of their way to ensuring that their report was published in an easy read format so that an opportunity for the very young people and children that we're talking about were able to gain access to the report in a way that made sense to them, but also then allowed them to feed back. I also welcomed the involvement of inclusion ambassadors in this, which brought the word and the lived experience of children into the report. And I do think it's worth noting that some of the findings of the inclusion ambassadors sat slightly at odds with some of the, or not some of, but a substantial amount of evidence that the committee heard. But I do think it's interesting and right to put on the record that the inclusion ambassadors did feel special, that they did have kind and understanding teachers. And they did ask that teachers, or they did give evidence that teachers took the time to ask the pupils' needs. And they did suggest that making connections between teachers and themselves was important in the experience that they had as ASN pupils. Now, I put this on the record because I think it is important to understand, and indeed a number of contributions from around the chamber have shown that there are some people who are able to navigate this system in a very successful way, which means it can be done for all children. And I think it's important that we recognise that. It does not take away from the very lived reality of the significant number of parents who contributed evidence to say that there are massively marked failures in the provision, some of it postcode orientated, some of it just with the whole system of advice, forms, committees, acronyms that are put in. And it is clearly true that parents are left fighting every day and that pupils are being let down by the mismanagement of the ASL provision. But I felt it was important just to point that out, but not to detract from anything else. The support that are needed by young people has, to all effect, been dismantled over a period of time, in part, as the Cabinet Secretary rightly pointed out, because of the massive increase in numbers and the expectation that falls on them. But when we look at the provision for speech and language therapy, when we look at the provision for CAMHS, when we look at the provision for assistance support and additionally trained teachers with regard to needs, we are seeing the system being stretched to the point where we hear the truly frightening examples given of a child being at the back of the hall, effectively left abandoned. When we hear contributions that reflected that from two different geographic areas in Scotland, but seemingly to be a way that provision is handled in some schools for some children who find it really challenging to be in class. And it goes to much to the heart of the report about the need for mainstreaming. The question of masking by pupils was raised by a number of people, and I welcome the government's confirmation of a literature review on this, and I would push, as others have done, for a date when this will be available. Literature reviews are very challenging to do but are not time consuming, and it would be useful because I think that would be a powerful contribution to the debate that we're having. There is also within this report a very strong urgency, because we look at the deficiencies that have been addressed that are affecting thousands of parents and pupils. And as we've heard, Morgan reported this many years ago, and the committee found, broadly speaking, exactly the same outcomes, but we are no further forward in respect of this. The delays in providing the support and specialist provision in mainstreaming has affected the view that I think parents now take of mainstreaming. Mainstreaming, when it was originally proposed and when it was rolled out, was an incredibly effective and supported way to say that these young people, where they are able, have a right to be in mainstream education, to play with children, to be in an environment that is educational. The challenge is, as with the increasing numbers of additional needs, perhaps it has become something that has stopped being a priority in the provision that's given. It was an easier thing to remove support from, thus making it inappropriate for significantly more children in this time. Time is short, but I would like to finish with just two points. One from paragraph 29 of the report, where the committee rightly said there are disturbing accounts of the impact on children and young people with ASN health and mental health well-being. disturbing accounts, that should ring not just alarm bells, but just take us to the very front to see exactly what it is that we are going to do about this. And to final, to go to a very powerful contribution from my colleague Alex Rowley, and simply really to ask the government, you've heard what has taken place in this chamber, what now? Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Whitfield. And I now call on Ros McCall to close on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. Up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It's a pleasure to close this afternoon's debate on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. This has been an incredibly important debate and an incredibly important report. So I would also like to go on record to place my thanks to the committee members and to the clerks for producing it, and to the inclusion ambassadors, the parents, the carers and teachers that all came and gave evidence to the committee. The challenges for Scotland's education system of dealing with the growing number of young people with additional supports need have been articulated by every speaker this afternoon. But I'd like to take a moment to look at the simple facts before us before I highlight some of their contributions. The number of pupils with additional support needs has increased significantly. 69,587 pupils were classed with needing additional support in school in 2010. By 2030, it was 259,036 pupils. Now, for the same time, that number of ASN teachers has decreased from 3,524 to 2,898. So in the very simplistic of terms, back in 2010, one ASN teacher was supporting 20 pupils. By 2023, that same ASN teacher is now supporting 90 pupils. It doesn't matter if the increase in the numbers of ASN pupils is down to better recording or diagnosis. The fact remains, the number of teachers are down. Now, the Cabinet Secretary has highlighted resources, and this is, of course, important. And she's also highlighted the 17,330 support assistants that is into our education system to deal with these more complex needs. But so far, that hasn't been reflected in reality, as the committee report so eloquently highlights. So now I'm going to turn to some contributions. I want to thank the convener, Sue Weber, for summary of the report, which I think highlighted everything and all the issues excellently. I also want to highlight the personal stories given by Willie Rennie and Jeremy Balfour. To hear of a young man being set up to fail due in part to rotation of staff is just not acceptable. And to hear from Jeremy Balfour that there is a young person with autism and their family who are having to deal with suicidal thoughts because of their education is deeply shocking. And a child who is only able to be educated in isolation 2 days a week, well, that, if nothing else, is an example of what we must recognise here today and what we must change. Liam Kerr, Sue Weber, Gillian Mackay all mentioned the disparity in council processes, with some needing formal diagnosis and some progressing without it. That must be addressed. My colleague Liam Kerr has highlighted the need for honesty in this issue and how we need to accept that there is a problem before we can initiate the change. And parents, young people are angry, and that has been highlighted right across the chamber today by many people, but in particular Willie Rennie, Pam Duncan-Glancy and by Martin Whitfield. And lastly, I noticed that the Cabinet Secretary has mentioned that there will soon be produced the ASL Action Plan and that her commitment to the updated guidance with the recommendations from the committee for some time early next year. And I sincerely look forward to reading them. The committee's report describes the situation for families, young people and teachers dealing with the new reality as intolerable, as we have heard many times. And I want to spend some time reiterating the main points raised in the report, because quite frankly, Deputy Presiding Officer, its findings illustrate that this SNP government has let them down. Reading the evidence given to the committee's inquiry, I was struck by the anger and frustration felt by parents and carers when trying to get the best support for their child. This includes the difficulties and delays experienced by parents and carers in getting the correct support, including long delays in diagnosis and access to support services such as CAMHS, a position that was also shared by several educators and teaching unions. I note that the committee considers that such delays are unacceptable, and it recommends the Scottish Government work closely with bodies such as NHS Scotland, the Royal College of Speech and Language Therapists, CAMHS and COSLA, to identify the causes of such lengthy delays and to assure a more joined-up approach. Parents and carers also spoke of not being listened to, particularly where they felt that the presumption of mainstreaming was not meeting the needs of their child. And even though the overwhelming view, both in written and in oral evidence, was that the principle of presumption of mainstreaming is laudable and should be supported, concerns were raised around the implementation of this policy and the barriers faced in practice when mainstreaming was in place and the only option. The committee was extremely concerned by what it heard regarding the negative personal experiences of ASL provision and the implementation of presumption of mainstreaming and the detrimental impact this has had on some pupils. And I want to join others in commending the work done by teachers and support staff in providing support for pupils with additional support needs. But I am also deeply concerned to hear of these pressures, which are leaving them feeling overwhelmed and burnt out. But given the increase in pupils and the teachers, and that teachers are reducing, then it's hardly surprising. The truth is that the Scottish Government's handling of the implementation of ASN provision is yet another example of a gap between policy ambition and the actual implementation. So in conclusion, Deputy Presiding Officer, I again thank the committee for a full and thorough report, and I urge the Scottish Government to take forward the recommendations for the mutual benefit not only of ASN pupils but teachers alike. But I must correct Bill Kidd's point on the Morgan Review. The SNP had pledged to implement the Morgan Review within this Parliament. We're 4 years on, and given that it had four recommendations for delivery, those being value-driven leadership, an open culture of communication support and challenge underpinned by trust, respect and positive relationships, resource alignment, and methodology for delivery of knowledge, learning and practice development. Well, given that the report before us highlights the same recommendations, and I know that it does take time, but I would say time is running out. Again, here we stand debating a broken promise from this SNP government, and again, it's Scotland's children that pay the price.
Thank you, Ms McCall, and I now call on Cabinet Secretary Jenny Gilruth to close. Up to 8 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would like to thank members for contributing to what has been a really powerful debate this afternoon on a subject of significant importance to the children and young people of this country. And I welcome the committee's scrutiny and challenge on additional support for learning. And as we've all heard this afternoon, Presiding Officer, a third of our school population now have an identified additional support need. So today's debate has, as a common theme, asked for urgency from government. And I think we must continue to work together to address the challenges that remain in our system. That is the only way we can positively improve the experiences and outcomes for those children and young people. But I will reflect on that element in relation to urgency. And just to Ros McCall's point in relation to the Morgan Review, I'm sure she will also reflect on the progress that has been made through the Additional Support for Learning Action Plan thus far. As I outlined in my opening statement and in my response to the committee, we have been working steadily with our partners over the course of this parliamentary term to address the challenges that Angela Morgan identified. And we have a number of actions underway that I've alluded to. But there is no quick fix here, Presiding Officer, and I absolutely recognise that there is much more that we will need to do as we respond to changing need, particularly post-pandemic. Now, I want to touch on some of the contributions from committee members that have been made this afternoon, Presiding Officer, a number of really important contributions. Liam Kerr is absolutely right to point to the stark findings of the needs of additional support for learning pupils not being met, and I think this reflects the point that Willie Rennie made in his intervention on me earlier about the strength of feeling from parents and often young people themselves. I think Ros McCall talked to the anger as well. I know members are probably fed up of my anecdotal stories of when I last taught in schools, but additional support needs are emotive, and I know how frustrating it can also be for classroom teachers when that isn't in place, that additionality, that support. Now, Pam Duncan-Glancy spoke about the power of education and her family's fight on her behalf. I know she's not in the chamber this afternoon, presiding officer, but undoubtedly because of her family's fight, she is here today. But they shouldn't have had to fight. And no parent and no carer in Scotland should have to fight for the rights of their children to access their right to education. And that has happened, as we have heard from members, too often in the course of this afternoon's debate. Now, on coordinated support plans, or CSPs, Ms Duncan Glancy is right to point to the differentiation we can see in uptake. She is also right to point to the code of practice, which is being updated, of course, to address this anomaly. She also should know that for some working in our schools, a statutory CSP is not necessarily the path appropriate for that young person. As I think we heard from Jeremy Balfour, needs evolve over time, and we should be careful not to presume a statutory CSP is always the right approach for every young person. Gillian Mackay spoke about the levels of workload associated with the challenges faced by classroom teachers, particularly post-pandemic. And I have to say that this was a really key feature of my thinking last week in responding to Professor Louise Hayward's report on qualifications reform. We have got to be pragmatic about the bandwidth for reform. And as rightly pointed to, budget is also relevant. And much of my budget, I think, as Ms Mackay alluded to, is not legally committed. And it is worthwhile pointing out, though, that the education budget this year, presiding officer, stands at record levels, as does spending on additional support needs at £926 million. Yes, I will.
Liam Kerr.
I'm very grateful, and I actually recognise what the Cabinet Secretary is saying, albeit that the education budget has decreased to a little extent. But those are the inputs, right? What the committee is desperate to see and what people are desperate to see is the outputs. So will the Cabinet Secretary commit here and now to deliver what the committee has demanded for the people out there by 2026?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Mr Kerr for his intervention. He wants to talk about inputs. I talked about an input there. An output from last year was 725 extra pupil support assistants because of additionality coming from this government to support additional staff in the system. So I think we can evidence how our inputs are having an impact. And of course, on a range of the recommendations from the committee, I have accepted them because I recognise the challenge here, but the need to continue to support that additionality, which is exactly what the government's doing. Now, Ms Mackay, of course, made some suggestions, I think, from where that additionality that Mr Kerr spoke to might come from. And, of course, we're not yet in budget negotiations. I'm sure she will be having conversations with the Finance Secretary to that end. Presiding Officer, I was really sorry to hear the story recounted by Mr Rennie this afternoon. That story is exactly why things need to improve. Yes, I will do so.
Jeremy Balfour.
Cabinet Secretary, a lot of the practical decisions aren't made by you. They're made by local authorities.
I'm aware.
Can I encourage you to engage with them and to encourage them not to cut back vital services which affect many of the children we've been talking about? And what discussions will you be having with them over the next few months?
Always through the chair, Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I thank the member for his intervention. I am more than well aware that a range of powers rest with local authorities and not with me as Cabinet Secretary in relation to education. And actually, that is why the ASL Project Board, to which his colleague Liam Kerr spoke, is so important because, of course, COSLA are a key member of that board. This has to be a joint endeavour. I meet very regularly with COSLA on a range of different issues, as you may imagine. And, of course, COSLA will be key to driving the improvements we need to see in our schools and to protecting those budget lines, which I think is the point that the member was alluding to. Now, in my evidence to committee last year, I was very frank in my assessment of where things are currently working and where there are challenges. Mr Rennie spoke about mandatory training and the challenge between that and changing needs. And I think there is a challenge here for Scottish Government because I'm sure members will be aware that we cannot direct course content as a government to individual independent universities, nor would I wish to do so, although the committee may wish to consider some of the changes in approach to initial teacher education that have been adopted in Wales recently. But I also alluded in my opening response, presiding officer, to my intention to audit, essentially, from government the number of hours that are being taught in terms of ITE and ASM provision. I think it's important we hold that data. On issues surrounding school estate, which was a key feature of my committee appearance earlier in the year, as Mr Rennie will know, big schools in Fife are not a new feature of how we deliver education in that part of the world. But the local authority in that instance chooses to build larger schools, they would argue, because of the communities they serve. Many in Mr Rennie's constituency, including the village where I grew up, they serve a number of smaller villages, and therefore the local authority has a tendency to build larger school estates as a result. But The idea that that hasn't been considered in school estate design, I don't accept. And of course, since 2007, because of investment from this government, we've seen the quality of Scotland's school estate improve from just over 60% to, when the last statistics were published not a matter of weeks ago, presiding officer, over 91% of our schools in Scotland now in good or satisfactory condition. That is a dramatic improvement and something I would hope the Parliament could welcome. But of course, the SFT, as I think another member alluded to, have set out a 10-point plan in relation to the committee's recommendations, and I will continue to engage with them to that end. Presiding officer, Ruth Maguire spoke to the challenge of legislation and practice, and I absolutely agree with her about school culture, which in my experience is often about relationships in schools, and we've debated with regularity the issues in our schools on behaviour, something I know the committee considered and was mentioned by the convener in her opening comments. Perhaps Ms Maguire is right. An overt focus on legislation sometimes takes her eye away from what really matters, that cultural change. And she gave the example from emerging good practice in Ayrshire. And of course, my officials will be keen to note the progress that's made in that regard. Jeremy Balfour spoke to the importance of ASL specialist teachers. He will know, as I alluded to in my response to Mr Kerr, that we have protected funding for additional support for learning, and that has increased the number of pupil support assistants in Scotland's schools in the last year alone by 725. Presiding officer, I'm conscious of time, and in summing up, I want to thank again the committee for all their work on what is a hugely important topic in Scotland's changed education landscape post-pandemic. The Additional Support for Learning Action Plan update was to publish in advance of the committee's inquiry. I paused that update so that we in government could listen to the findings from this committee. I hope that they will look at the updated Additional Support for Learning Action Plan when it publishes in October and reflect and recognise that some of the things they have asked government to do today are being directly taken forward through the work of the Action Plan. Presiding officer.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. And I now call on Evelyn Tweed to close on behalf of the Education, Children and Young People Committee. Up to 9 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I'm delighted to close this debate on behalf of the Education, Children and Young People Committee. Given that currently over a third of all pupils in our schools have additional support needs, this was an inquiry the committee was very keen to undertake. It is relatively unusual for the Education, Children and Young People Committee to actually ever be able to carry out an inquiry on a topic of its choosing. We are usually kept very busy with reactive work, very often looking at draft legislation. So when the opportunity arises to do some proactive work, we always take it. And when we do, we try to choose a topic that we think will have maximum impact. Listening to the Cabinet Secretary today responding to our report, I think we can safely say our inquiry has had impact. It will help address some of the barriers faced by pupils with additional support needs. The voices of those children and young people, their parents and carers and teachers involved in providing ASL were uppermost in committee members' minds throughout this inquiry. And as the convener highlighted, while we agreed with the policy intention behind the presumption of mainstreaming, the gap between the policy intention and how this has been implemented in practice was intolerable. I have listened to the contributions in the debate with great interest, and I was particularly pleased to hear members agreeing with the committee on how important it is that the barriers faced by children and young people with additional support needs and by their parents and carers are addressed as a matter of urgency. The convener mentioned the evidence we heard on improving the existing school estate, which would not cost a lot of money, but would greatly improve accessibility for pupils with ASN. Simple examples such as providing high back chairs in a particular part of the school where an autistic pupil could go to feel enclosed and private and allow them to regulate were mentioned. Another example was having a desk at the back of the classroom with some sensory toys. Those small changes can make a huge difference to a pupil with ASN. We recommended that Scottish Government should work with local government and relevant third sector organisations and pupils themselves to develop a suite of guidance to make existing schools as accessible as possible to those with sensory needs. So it's great to hear that the Scottish Government and the Scottish Futures Trust has developed a comprehensive step-by-step plan to address the issues raised by the committee, and we will be taking a keen interest in this going forward. Another element of our inquiry looked at resources. We were concerned to hear that resources for ASL provision had been reducing over time, and this has obviously been discussed in the Chamber today. We recommended that a more inclusive and joined-up approach towards resourcing more generally be adopted to help ensure that services for pupils with ASN could be met. For our final theme, we looked at the use of remedies for parents and carers when things are not working well. We looked in particular at the tribunal service. Under the 2004 Act, having a coordinated support plan, or a CSP, is the only way to access tribunal services, or there is also a route to access it through the equalities legislation. We were all too aware that the use of the tribunal should only be adopted as a last resort, and that ideally decisions about additional support for children and young people should be discussed and resolved as early as possible and led by parents. I will, Mr. Whitfield.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful for the member taking an intervention on that point. And to my earlier intervention, because of the UNCRC that is now in force here in Scotland, there are provisions more easily available to children, particularly I feel their parents, that may see local authorities and indeed the Scottish Government find themselves in court on situations that shouldn't arise if the matters are dealt with properly at earlier stages. Would the member agree with that?
Evelyn Tweed.
I certainly would, Mr. Whitfield. Thanks for your intervention. And resolved as early as possible and led by parents and carers and those delivering support. However, where this breaks down, it's imperative that families have access to the tribunal and are able to source appropriate legal support to assist them, regardless of their financial situation. We heard during evidence that the number of pupils with CSP is extremely small, and the criteria set out for qualifying for a CSP is creating a barrier to pupils and parents and carers being able to access the tribunal. We argued that all children and young people should have access to remedies and that access to the tribunal should be open to everyone. We also asked for further clarity on the use of plans to support pupils with ASN and recommended that the Scottish Government considers the compliance of these plans with GRFEC and UNCRC. I was pleased to hear the Cabinet Secretary confirm that the Scottish Government is committed to considering the compliance of the ASL legislation with UNCRC and that work is ongoing to provide further clarity on the relationship between the CSP and other children and young people plans within a staged intervention model. Turning now to contributions, Liam Kerr highlighted the high need for ASN provision and the high number of pupils where their needs were not met and the need to prioritise this area. Pam Duncan-Glancy spoke from a very personal perspective about her journey and that for some their opportunities are limited and there are too many barriers for ASN pupils. Change was needed at pace. Gillian Mackay noted that there were issues with the coordinated support plans that required to be resolved. Willie Rennie highlighted issues with the system, meaning people having to fight for their rights, but the system should be there to support them. Ruth Maguire shared some lived experience from pupils and parents that was heard during the committee proceedings and the difficulties people faced navigating the system, highlighting an implementation gap. Stuart McMillan also highlighted families having to fight for ASL implementation and the huge gap in ASN provision in Infraglide. Presiding Officer, I would like to finish by echoing the convener's words. We owe it to all children and young people with additional support needs and their parents and carers to ensure that the barriers they face in our schools are addressed without further delay, and we do get it right for every child. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on additional support for learning. It is now time to move on to the next item of business, which is consideration of business motion 14652 in the name of Jamie Hepburn on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau on Climate Change Emissions Reduction Targets Scotland Bill, timetable for consideration. And I call on Jamie Hepburn to move the motion.
Move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. And I call on Graham Simpson to speak to and move amendment 14652.1. Up to 5 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And I move the amendment to the business motion in my name. Now, that's not something that I do lightly, but I do so because I passionately believe in Parliament giving its members ample time to scrutinise legislation. We should all know that rushed legislation can be bad legislation. So let me first say what the Minister's motion does. The business motion seeks to set a timetable for dealing with the Climate Change Bill. In trying to amend it, I'm only interested in that timetable and not in the bill itself. Safe to say that it's an important piece of legislation. Now, the Minister wants the following timetable. Stage one would be on Thursday, the 10th of October. And should it pass that hurdle, then stage two would be complete by Tuesday, the 29th. Of October. Members will immediately realise that this takes in our two-week October recess. That in itself is an issue that I think we should seek to avoid. But we can probably live with it. So having completed stage two by October the 29th, the Minister then wants stage three to be done and dusted on October the 31st. That gives members and officials just 2 days to turn around amendments to what is a bill that has a great deal of interest in it. Yep. Now, Parliament can act at pace and has done on occasions in emergencies, but the only reason we're being asked to do so on this occasion is to spare the government's blushes. And that's because under the law as it stands, which this bill seeks to amend, the government has to produce a draft climate change plan by the end of November, and it's nowhere near doing that. That's the government's problem, and it's their fault, quite frankly. Parliament is not here to spare their blushes or to get them out of a hole. Yeah. We're here to do our jobs properly. Now, the NZ committee has been very careful not to express a view on timetabling, but they have written about, quotes, the importance of there being adequate time between stages two and three for the implications of any stage two amendment agreed in committee being carefully considered, close quotes. In no one's world, yes, I'll take an intervention.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful for Graeme Simpson taking an intervention on that point. And of course, it's not for the committee to decide on stage three. That is for this chamber and this place. But it is right for this chamber to take into account concerns that the committee may have, that adequate time is provided between stage two, which will take place within the committee, and the subsequent stage three proceedings here in the chamber, and that indeed the purposes of your amendment is to give as much time as is reasonably practicable, given the challenge the government find themselves in with this amendment that you've moved today, and we will be supporting it.
Graeme Simpson.
Well, I'm very pleased to hear that. Mr. Whitfield is absolutely right, because in no one's world is 2 days enough for this. Not even the Minister's, if he's being honest about it. My amendment, if accepted, would set the stage three date as November the 7th. That's an extra week from what the Minister is proposing. And even that's probably too short. So the Minister should see this as a sensible compromise. Presiding Officer, Parliament needs to be able to do its job properly. Scrutiny is an essential part of our work here, but we need to have the time to do it. So MSPs have a simple choice today between the Minister's rushed two-day deadline and my nine-day one, it's quite obvious which is the better, and it's not the Minister's.
Thank you, and I call on Jamie Hepburn to respond on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau. Up to 5 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and let me first of all say thank you for reminding the Chamber I speak on behalf of the Bureau, and this is the Bureau's position and not just my position. Presiding Officer, the Climate Change Scotland Act 2009, unless or until it is changed, requires the Government to bring forward a draft climate change plan by the 22nd of November of this year to set policies and proposals for meeting our emissions reduction targets. The Climate Change Committee has given conclusive advice that the 2030 target of 75% emissions reductions set by Parliament in 2019 on a cross-party basis is out of reach, and therefore we have to adjust our target framework before we can bring forward a credible climate change plan. To ensure we are not in breach of legal obligations, we therefore need to ensure the bill before Parliament is enforced by the 22nd of November to make the necessary changes to the law as it stands. As Parliament is aware, the Scotland Act 1998 provides a four-week period after any bill is passed by the Scottish Parliament for the UK and Scottish law officers, as well as the Secretary of State for Scotland, to consider that bill. The Presiding Officer cannot present a bill for Royal Assent until after that period has concluded. The period of time to actually obtain Royal Assent after that period is out with the Government's control, but takes on average about 1.5 weeks. This means there is a period of about 5.5 weeks after Stage 3 before a bill can receive Royal Assent. While in exceptional circumstances, the Government can ask law officers and the Secretary of State to agree to expedite their post-Stage 3 considerations and advise the Presiding Officer that they do not intend to take any action to prohibit the Presiding Officer from seeking Royal Assent, the law officers and the UK Government cannot, of course, be compelled to do this. Therefore, seeking to agree a timetable that does not allow, and I think it's important that Parliament hears this, and then I'll give way to Mr Harvey. Therefore, seeking to agree a timetable that does not allow sufficient time for the statutory post-Stage 3 period risks this bill not being enforced in time and bringing the Government into breach of legal requirements. That is the position that Parliament could be determining this evening. I'll give way to Mr Harvey.
Patrick Harvey.
I'm grateful to the Minister for giving way, and I think he's aware that opposition parties on the Bureau do understand the need for an expedited process, and we've all acknowledged that we're not going to get the full in-depth scrutiny that we would from a normal legislative process. But given that the Government recognised the need for this bill months ago, why has it come to the point where he's asking for a process of just 2 days between stages 2 and 3? And does he really think that that is adequate reflection period for members and for the Government to understand the consequences of stage 2 amendments in order to frame stage 3 amendments? I don't think that's enough, and I think a week is about the bare minimum.
Minister.
Well, I think in the ordinary run of circumstances, I would certainly agree with the fundamental points that Patrick Harvey has made. What I would say, of course, is that initially it had been my hope, my expectation, that we could have worked with the committee to get into a place where we would have not got into the situation, the circumstances that we would have to seek to engage with the UK Government. And clearly, that is a position that the Government here is going to have to do now, irrespective of the timescale that we agree this evening. But we did want to initially have a timescale that would have not put us in that place and would have also enabled Parliament to have sufficient time between stages 1, 2 and 3 to go through the usual process of consideration, albeit on an expedited basis. But having engaged with, and I'll give way in a minute because I'm about to mention, having engaged with the convener, that was not the committee's perspective. I had to hear that, I had to listen to that. So we got to a stage where, reluctantly, we were going to present one that would have constrained time for Parliament, but a timescale that could have seen us complete this by the October recess, which would have enabled us to meet the time frame necessary for the UK Government to give consideration to these matters. But it was very clear that that was not where the committee was inclined to go, so we had to present an alternative timetable, and then once I've given way to Mr Mountain, I can go on further to say where we are now.
Edward Mountain.
Thank you, Minister, for giving way. I just want to just reiterate to the Parliament the timescales, and I do so as an individual, although I am the convener of the committee. It was on in August 2023, we became aware that the government wouldn't meet the deadlines. In fact, there was a ministerial statement in this chamber on the 19th of April telling us we wouldn't meet the deadlines. I met on behalf of the committee in April, May, June, July and August and September, asking for the bill to be produced before the 5th of September, which was the date that it was eventually laid in the chamber, which gave the committee precious little time to take evidence. And I would just like it on record that the committee have worked extremely hard to meet the government's deadlines, which have been tight and unnecessarily tight if they produced the bill when we originally asked for it in May. And we're at the stage now where the committee are having to meet during the sessions of this Parliament in order to get the bill stage one debate forward. So I think that it would be right for the Minister to acknowledge the work of the committee and the fact that this problem is of his making, not the committee's.
Minister?
I'm not going to denigrate the committee. I'm very grateful for the time the convener has given me, and I recognise that they have tried to accommodate the government's concerns as much as has been possible. And actually, the intervention that Mr Mountain has just made makes me realise I did not respond to one of Mr Harvey's points. The challenge we faced in producing the bill in that timescale that's laid out is, first of all, we had to wait and hear what the Climate Change Committee had to say, and then we were immediately into an election period. Now, I would imagine if we had, as a government, laid a bill before Parliament during that election period, right now we'd be hearing a cacophony of noise from opposition members saying, how dare we introduce a bill during the election period? So that is why we had to meet. Mr Simpson talked about a compromise position. Frankly, what is before us right now, in the name of the Bureau that I am asking Parliament to vote for, is the compromise position. The government's preference had been to get this done and dusted by October recess, so we would not be in danger of contravening what is required under the Scotland Act and putting the legal position at jeopardy. That was very clearly not going to be able to be carried. I have been willing to compromise. That's what's on the table right now. I think we should agree to it. I think we should get on with it. And of course, whatever is agreed tonight will require me and the government to engage with the UK government to see if we can secure a shortening of the royal assent. But Parliament should be aware that cannot be guaranteed. And if we agree an even longer timescale this evening, then we are in serious danger of putting that position in great jeopardy.
Thank you. And the question is that Amendment 14652.1 in the name of Graeme Simpson, which seeks to amend Motion 14652 in the name of Jamie Hepburn on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau on Climate Change Emissions Reduction Targets Scotland Bill, timetable for consideration, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we'll move to a vote, and there'll be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.